All right. I'm going to get the deacons to help us go over to the fellowship hall and get some chairs so we can seat everybody. But we, hey, I'm glad you're here. Somebody said, we're going to have a bad crowd today. I said, it's a lot better than I had last Sunday. Amen. Me and Gerald was in here. Gerald was shouting me down. But we had a good time anyway. Thank you so much for being here today. We wanted to do this for anybody that wanted to be here and was able and well and all that. So thank you for coming. We're looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us. We don't have any real announcements because we've kind of had to put everything on hold. And so we're kind of just seeing how things go going forward. So I don't have any real announcements other than this. We will have service Wednesday night. So you come back. I've talked to our youth leaders and we're ready to roll. So come back Wednesday night. Just pray. Come. Wash your hands. Say your prayer. Germs and Jesus are everywhere, right? We're going to do the best we can to try to navigate this next surge, whatever this is that we're going through. But anyway, I'm glad to see you here this morning. We're looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us. I believe he's got something for us today. If nothing else, it's nice to be in the air conditioning. Amen. It is hot outside. Amen. But we're glad that you're here today, and we're looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us. And I also want to welcome those who are watching with us online. That is a ministry that we never dreamed that we would get such mileage out of that stuff as we have had. We got it put in and right out of the chute. It became our crutch for ministry. And so the Lord has really used this online ministry. And, of course, we've picked up people that watch with us that don't even live here, that other places in the world. And we're very thankful to have people that they must really be hurting for some good preaching if they're listening to us. Amen. But we're glad to have folks watch along with us. And our folks who are either sick or concerned or taking caution, we want you to know we love you, we understand, and we're praying for you. And I want to encourage everybody here and everybody at home watching to let us know if there's anything we can do. If there's anything going on, if somebody's sick, if somebody's got something going on, let us know. We've got some who are still fighting this thing. Justin Albritton is doing a good bit better. He's had a good couple of days. He's got a long ways to go. So we continue to pray for him. Mr. Ronnie and Miss Judy Savage's granddaughter, Kayla Price, she's still in the hospital. She's fighting, and so we want to pray for her. Bobby Bearden Jr. is doing a little bit better, but he's got a long ways to go, so we'll continue to pray for him and for Mr. Bobby and Miss Leela as they go through all of this together. And his wife, Miss Pat, she now has it, and so we want to pray for her and pray for their family. But we're just continuing to press forward, pray for one another and help one another, and so we're glad to see you here in the house of the Lord. Is there anything else we need to announce before we carry on with the service? We're going to have kind of we call it a limited service, brief service. Brother Ross is going to lead us in a couple of songs. We're going to preach, and then we'll let y'all go. But we are glad to have you here and looking forward to what the Lord has in store for us this morning. So I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer. And remember, 6:30 Wednesday night, and we're going to look towards going back to Sunday school and service next Sunday. And so just pray with us. You know, for a couple of weeks there, it seemed like every day we got another call. Somebody was sick. But we seem to be over that hump. We went this entire week without any bad news. And so we thank the Lord for that, praying for that this next week. And so we look forward to hopefully going back to our regular schedule next Sunday. All right, let's pray. Father, we love you. What a blessing it is to be in your house. God, I thank you today for our people. Lord, we pray today for those who are sick, for those who are recovering. God, for those who have perhaps been exposed that are just praying to stay well. God, we pray today for our people that you'll continue, Lord, to just put your hand on each one of our folks, protect us, Lord, and keep us. We pray for our community today, as we know there are not only people from Antioch who are suffering, but, Lord, there are many people in our community, our state, even our country, as we see this stuff coming back around. So, Lord, we pray today that you'd just help us not only to experience healing and to see this thing eventually go away, but, Lord, that we'll find what it is that you'd have for us to learn in the middle of this. What is it that this message is being sent to say to your people? And I pray that we would hear it and receive it, Lord, and do what you've put us here to do. So I pray, God, that you'd strengthen us today. I pray that you would move in our hearts and use today the singing and the preaching and the message of your word presented both in song and sermon to do something in our hearts and to help us to leave here better than we were when we got here. Lord, we pray today that your word just speak in our hearts. We pray that your spirit would rest in this place and give us comfort and peace and encouragement, Lord, as we come to draw nourishment from the strength of your word. Lord, bless Brother Ross and these that play instruments today, and we pray that everything said and done, from those who watch with us online, from those who were able to come and be in attendance, to every song and every sermon, Lord, we just pray that everything today would be presented as an offering to you, and that it might be, Lord, acceptable and pleasant in your sight, that you be pleased as we come today for no other reason than to worship you. Be God today in this place, and we'll thank you for what you do. In Christ's name, amen. Amen.
All right, y'all help me as we sing, Shine, Jesus, Shine. Amazing grace, my chains are gone.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God
feels good to worship. I've captured the iPad. Just to be in the Lord's house and in His presence, such a blessing and such a privilege that I don't think before 18 months ago we really realized what a great privilege it was. And who would have ever dreamed in my entire life before 2020, the only thing that would ever prevent a church service was terrible, terrible weather. And if it wasn't for terrible weather and power outages and roads closed, we were going to have church. I even remember having church a bunch of times in my life when we didn't have power. We just lit candles and sat there and preached in the dark. And I've preached revivals before where storms came and knocked the power out. And they asked me if I could preach, and I said, yeah, I preached to a completely dark room one time at Locust Bayou Baptist Church outside of Hampton and Arkansas, between Hampton and Camden, Arkansas. And 3 years in a row, I did revival up there, and every year, the power got knocked out by a storm, and so they finally quit asking me to come. you understand, it's like pulling teeth for a preacher, I believe, and I don't say this to be critical of anybody else, but just my own makeup is, it's an act of Congress to want to cancel a service, and so it's just been it's been interesting. And I guess last Sunday, I was one of them things after we recorded. Brother Gerald and I recorded on Saturday. He sets that up to premiere so that we don't have any internet interference, so that the broadcast would go out smooth. And I had a transparent moment, and I guess I said enough about being discouraged. I had people messaging me from all over the country telling me they was praying for me, and I appreciated that. And it really has been a challenging time, I'm very thankful anyway to be here today and to see all of you here. So if you have your Bible, open the book of Galatians. The book of Galatians in chapter 5 is where we'll be. But I do thank you for your encouragement. I thank you for your prayers. I've had people texting me and messaging me and people encouraging us and our leadership on decisions that we've made, that they're behind us, they support us, and you just don't know what that means. You don't know what a blessing it is. This is the only time, I guess, in my life and in my ministry that I can remember there being situations that you had to make decisions on that there was absolutely no way to say for sure that it was right or wrong. There's no absolute. There's no plumb line. It's like we just got to hope we're doing the right thing and go for it. And so it's been interesting. But we've got good folks, and our church has done so well through this, and we give the Lord all the glory for that. But very thankful today to be in the house of the Lord. Galatians chapter 5, that's right after chapter 4, if you're looking still. Y'all stand with us as we honor His Word. Y'all going to have to get crunk for all the people that are not here now. We're going to have to have the program. Brother Gerald took it all on his back last week. He ran a lap around the room, was throwing his Bible in the air. Back there we had us a time. Galatians chapter 5, we're just going to read verse 1 and take off from there. I'm going to do my best to preach the entire book of Galatians, so we'll see how that goes. You laughing, but I'm telling the truth. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Very simply this morning, we're going to preach on the subject of those first two words in chapter 5, stand fast. Father, we love You. We need You today, and we ask You, Lord, to visit with us as Your people. Bless those who are watching with us online. Bless this group that was able to come out, Lord, and make my day. I pray today that You'd minister to every heart. I pray today You'd speak in power, and I pray that Your will be done. Lord, we didn't come today just to check off a box and say that we came. We came today to worship, and we came today to hear from heaven. So I pray as we fix our eyes on the wonderfulness of Jesus Christ, I pray today that You'd speak and we'd listen. And I pray we'd leave here in obedience to Your Word, having done what we came here to do today, and we'll thank You and praise You for it all. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You can be seated. So, this is kind of a funny thing to say, stand fast, right? I mean, unless you're sitting down, you just jump up real quick. Standing fast is kind of a funny thing to say. So you've heard this expression, and Paul even uses this in Hebrews chapter 7. He makes the statement, hold fast to the profession of your faith. That thought of holding fast is like taking a hold of a rope and not letting go no matter what. Don't let go of the rope. Hold fast to the rope. Well, this phrase, stand fast, is kind of in light of a military term. You've heard this phrase before if you've ever watched war movies or anything like that. Well, they'd make this statement, hold the line. Hold the line. Because the front line of defense would be basically a shield for everything else that was going on. So if, for whatever reason, there was a weakness or a hole in the front line, I'll give you another analogy, football. If your line doesn't work, it doesn't matter if you got the best quarterback, the best receiver, the best running back, the best tight end. If you can't block and you can't hold the line, then you're not going to be able to exercise all those gifts that you've been given. In this context, Paul is telling this church at Galatia, which this is a church now in Greece, but a church that was not necessarily made up of Grecians, but made up of ghouls. It was made up of a people who generations before had immigrated into this area and were made up of mostly the descendants of barbarians. So these people, though they maybe were physically something, maybe they were militarily, maybe they would have been impressive, maybe they would have been a people you'd have been scared to be around, spiritually they were very fickle. And so Paul, writing to this group of people, this is people that was comprised mostly of slaves. And Paul's writing to this group, and he's trying to have a discussion with them through this letter based on something he had heard on what we believe was his third missionary trip to Corinth. So while at Corinth, he receives word that this group of people who had been converted to Christ through the preaching of the free grace of God have now been a target of a group of people known as Judaizers or legalizers. That they came in from the region of Palestine and they came in almost like missionaries to try to undo the teaching of this New Testament church. And they did so with this mindset that instead of coming in and combating wholeheartedly what Paul and the new church had been preaching, let's come in and mingle our old teachings with what they say they believe now. And the subject at hand was circumcision. And so their point was, yeah, that grace, that's good stuff. Amen, hallelujah, but you need to do this too. And it could go all the way back to Acts chapter 15, where there was a group teaching and preaching that, yes, you can be saved, but you're not saved if you're not circumcised. If you don't take this covenant sign of the promise of God in your body and your flesh, then you're not saved. You don't have that. That's legalism. Legalism is where we look around in the room and we create a set of rules and we use those rules to hold one another to certain standards. Jesus came to do rid with standards and rules and laws, and now we operate freely in the grace of God. But we all have legalistic tendencies, and this is what happened when that group of new converts heard this teaching, because we all want something spectacular. So they thought, well, what if we did both? What if we continued to walk in the principles and the truths of the preaching of the grace of God, but we also combined with that the teaching of Judaism and let that come along beside us? Wouldn't that make us some kind of super saint? Well, Paul's writing to the people, and he even makes the statement later in this chapter that a little bit of leaven leavens the whole bunch. That one drop of poison poisons an entire bucket of water. That one hint of Judaism means that you're no longer teaching the principles of the New Testament church, which is that a brother or sister in Christ is free from the law, they're free from condemnation, they're free from checking boxes and rules and all of these things, that we now walk in the free grace of God because we've been washed in the blood of Jesus and our sins are gone. There are still denominational teachings, and I'll say this because I don't condemn any denomination, because there ain't nobody worse than Baptists. Had an old preacher tell me one time, there ain't no pope like a Baptist pope. Amen? And we see this even in Baptist churches, is that we offer free salvation, but you profess Christ as your Lord and Savior and you'll be saved, but you better be baptized or you're not really saved. You better join that church or you're not really saved. You better take communion or you're not really saved. You better give in the offering or you're not really saved. You better show up for this or you're not saved. You're not a part of this group. You don't do this or that. See, the point of freedom is this. If I'm serving God out of legal obligation, I'm not serving God. I'm serving me. If I'm serving God because I have been told to and not because in my heart I desire to, because of what He did, that's not freedom. So we can't crack whips and make people live up to these standards. We want people to be challenged by the freedom they have in Jesus to give it all and surrender to the Lord and live their lives to please Him. And so Paul writes to this people, and through the book of Galatians, he gives us nuggets, and I don't want to preach word upon word, precept upon precept, because we just don't have time for that in one service, but I do want to grab some nuggets from each of the six chapters and give them to you as we look at this book based around what Paul is challenging this people to do, and what I believe in this day of political turmoil, this day in which we're faced with round two, it seems, of a pandemic, and I know as the pastor and the spiritual leader, I know how confusing these times are, and I think to myself, Lord, if I'm confused, I'm sure that there are a lot of people who are confused today about the mission and the eyesight of the church and where we're going and how we're going to get there. I even told somebody yesterday, I'd give anything to see where our church would be right now if we would have had these last 18 months without a pandemic. But God knows what He's doing. And God knew we were here for this very hour. And so God's using us in the middle of this to continue to stand fast. Hold the line. We all want to advance, right? We all want to be on the offense. We all want to grow. We all want to go forward. But sometimes you have to dig in your heels and hold your ground. You have to fight through turmoil, fight through trial, fight through heartache, fight through heart. You have to dig in and say, look, we've come this far and it's too far to go back now. Maybe we can't go forward like we want to at this time, but we'll never be able to go forward again if we give up the ground that we've already made up. Stand fast. That's what he's telling this church. You got something in the truth and you let somebody take it from you.
You let somebody come in and bring in this false teaching that mingled in this process through which you now think your salvation and your liberty is determined by something you can do, and that's not true. So Paul, through these nuggets of Scripture, goes in Galatians chapter 1. This is where he jumps in verse 6 through 10. I want to read this to you. I'm not going to preach through all this. I just want to read these to you and let the Word speak for itself. Galatians chapter 1, verse 6 through 10. This is after his salutation. Paul says this: I marvel, a word that means I'm amazed. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, I say now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than the gospel you have received, let him be accursed. For do I persuade men or God? And do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ. Another nugget that Paul gives us in the book of Galatians, verses you've heard before and held to in your life. He's driving home this point to these people that it's Jesus plus nothing. It's Jesus plus nothing. Paul said, Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. In Galatians chapter 3, Paul gives us, again, more nuggets through Scripture that we hold to. Verses, again, that you have heard and you have heard preached. Paul said in Galatians chapter 3, in verse 24, wherefore the law was our schoolmaster. The law was a system of teaching to accomplish a goal. The law was not the goal. The law was to get you to the goal. And here's what he says the goal was. The law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. That the law was a schoolmaster. Nobody goes to school to stay in school. Nobody goes to the first grade to stay in the first grade. Nobody goes to the 10th grade to stay in the 10th grade. You graduate. The purpose of school is to be educated so that you can graduate and go on with your life. The purpose of the law was to graduate the people of God into an understanding that there is no system whatsoever that can set us free. No matter how hard we tried, no matter how high we reached, no matter how many boxes we checked, we were lost. We were sinful. And then came Jesus. The perfect, I don't even know if compliment is the right word, but he came and he took the law and he folded it up and he put it in his pocket and he said, don't worry about that, just come to me. Come to me. And so he continues on in chapter 4 and gives us again nuggets of truth that we hold to in the church today. In chapter 4, verse 4 through 7, you've heard these verses before. He said, but when the fullness of time was come, when the law had accomplished all it could accomplish and had sowed the seed that it could sow, when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law. He was not an enemy of the law. He was the fulfillment of the law. He said in verse 5, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. I want to stop right there and talk about what he's saying. What he's saying is that the law basically signed us into slavery. What the law said, here, let's just simplify this and say there's 10 rules. And of those 10 rules, let's go around the room. Every one of us has broken a rule. So whether you broke number 1 or whether you broke number 10, guilty. And so the whole point of the law was to show us and teach us and train us that we were lost. And when the accomplishment of the law, when the law had clearly stated that we were all in trouble, that we were all insufficient, that all had sinned and come short of the glory of God, when that time came, Jesus comes under the law to redeem us. The law had sold us into slavery. We were enslaved by our sin and we didn't know it without the law. But the law taught us that we were enslaved, that we had been bought and owned by sin, and Jesus came, notice the word that he used, to redeem us. And that word redeem means to buy us back. He came to pay the price for our sin so that now all the heap of load and burden and bondage that the law had put on our back, Jesus came, and you know the song says, Jesus paid it all. He took that debt, he took that burden, he took that weight, and he put it on his back. He paid the ultimate price. He paid the cost so that we could be saved. And so he says to us there in 4, that he might redeem us who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And here's what he drives home in the next 2 verses. Because you are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your heart, crying, Abba, Father. I no longer have to approach God in this legalistic scenario through which I walk only in agonizing terror, fear. But now with the adoption of sons and the affection of my understanding of the Father, I now come to him in the same spirit in which Jesus did. We've said this many times about the reference in the Lord's Prayer, that Jesus tells us to pray to his Father by saying, Our Father. So he's saying that through the adoption of sons, now we have become in the likeness of Christ a kinship to God. I am now a child of God. I am a son to God. And he says, if now I'm a son to God, I'm no longer a servant. Listen to what he says. Verse 7. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. He goes on. I'm going to skip chapter 5 because that's where we're going to end up, because that's where we started, because that's just the way I roll. Chapter 6. Verse 1, here's what he says. Here's what the law said. If a man's taken in a fault, hold him accountable. Beg for justice. Bring him before counsel. Hammer him. He deserves it. And we do. But here's what grace teaches. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. I preached not too long ago, we were talking about judgment in Matthew 7 and talked about, don't talk about other people's kids because your kids are going to live long enough to make you regret it. Amen? Your kid might not be what that kid was at that age, but they're going to do something stupid because they're yours. Amen? They inherited that gene. Can I get a witness in the house? They ain't saying nothing in here. Y'all give me a thumbs up on Facebook. Amen? They inherited that gene. Happy was a pistol, I'm a son of a gun. Amen? Anybody ever heard that before? I mean, we are what we are. So here we are. So the law says, guilty. And grace says, right. But Jesus said, I'll take the guilt. I'll take the blame. And so we now have the privilege and grace not to see if someone's met a checklist or a criteria that man has put in place. But here's the question. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? And if the answer is yes, circumcision, uncircumcision, red, yellow, black, white, man, woman, you're my brother and my sister in Christ. What a privilege it is to be under the grace of God. Verse 7 through verse 9. Be not deceived, God's not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that's what he's going to reap. Matthew 7, Jesus said, for with what judgment you judge is coming back. You want to judge somebody, judge them. But get ready. What he said in Galatians 6, 1, consider yourself, lest you also be tempted. I have heard people throw stones at somebody who committed adultery, and you know what they did 10 years later? I've heard people throw stones at people whose kids were heathens, and you know what they raised their kids to be? Heathens. Amen? I have heard people say what they wasn't going to do, and they did it. All of us preachers in the last 2 years, been a very humbling experience, because we all pounded our fists. We ain't canceling church for nothing. We love Jesus, and everybody that does don't. Well, we've learned don't say what you're not ever going to do. Amen? Listen what grace teaches us. Grace teaches us it's all right not to be perfect. It's all right not to be a superstar. Matter of fact, it's better that you recognize you're not ever going to be perfect. Because only then will you lean into the affection and the arms of Jesus for the things you need in your life. Because you get puffed up and think, look at us, look at me, look at this. Jesus is everything. And without Him, we're nothing. And so when Paul tells this group to stand fast, hold the line, he's saying don't forget the truth that got you here. The truth that took the checklist and tore it up. And now, what'd you do? You let somebody come in, pervert the gospel, and you broke out another checklist. And you started judging. And you started holding people up to these standards and up to these rules. He goes on and says, if we do what we do, we're going to reap what we sow. Verse 8, he says in Galatians chapter 6, for he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Verse 9, and let us not grow weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Verse 10, he said, as we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. That we ought to do good to everybody, but prioritize those who are members of the people of God. That we have to strengthen the family for the family to go out and reach the world. We cannot condemn others because we should have been condemned ourselves. We love them, we serve them, we respect them, we help them, but we don't do so at the expense of telling them the truth. And then we love the family of God, and we encourage the family of God, and we help the family of God. Y'all ready for the message? That was the introduction. Chapter 5, stand fast. The message is real quick. That's why I had such a wonderful introduction. Guy said one time the introduction to the message is the porch and the message is the house. So you don't need a great big introduction. But if you can't see the house from the porch, what's the point? Amen? Anyway, number one, stand fast in our freedom. Stand fast in our freedom. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 4, Peter says that we've been given. He says, given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. Stand fast on the truth of the Word of God. Stand fast on the principles of God. Hear what he says. Therefore, with that liberty we have from Christ, he said he made us free. Let's don't get entangled. It's like a spider web. It's like you grab at this law and then you grab at this principle and you grab at this rule and you grab at this thing, and the more we do, the more we water down and bind up the things of God, and we're not free to be what God has saved us and called us to be. We're just encapsulated by rules and by man's precepts, and it keeps us from being able to walk in the freedom of the Spirit of God. If we didn't have a Bible and we didn't have the Holy Ghost, we would need a whole bunch of rules to keep us straight. But we've got the Word of God as our source, and we've got the Spirit of God that gives to all men liberally and works in our heart to convict us and keep us straight, that we can trust the Lord and live in freedom. Stand fast in our freedom. Jesus would say it like this in John chapter 8, that if any man's free in the Son, he's free indeed. That means he's all the way free. I mean, he's completely free. What we say this morning? My chains are gone. I've been set free. You remember the title of that song? Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace. My chains are gone. He set us free. We have liberty in God through Jesus Christ our Lord. We stand fast in our freedom. Number two, I told you this is going to go fast. We stand fast in freedom. We stand fast on faith. So we find ourselves in this place, much like the church at Galatia, even though our hurdles may be different, they're hurdles nonetheless. So we find ourselves in these similar situations in which, what do we do? And how are we going to do it? And it would be so easy. And I heard just this week, I heard a testimony of a church that was planted 10 years ago, and a friend of mine had preached 10 years. He'd preached revival at that church, and they canceled the revival this year to let him know that they're going to be shutting the doors on that church because they've not been able to survive what these last couple years have done. It's one of the saddest commentaries that we're seeing in so many churches today. I want you to understand that we can't go by what we see. If we go by what we see, we'll fold our arms and sit in the corner and cry. So the Bible teaches us very simply, 2 Corinthians 5:7, For we walk by faith and not by sight. And here's what faith is. I love the Manly Beasley definition. Manly Beasley said, faith is believing something is so when it's not so in order for it to be so because God said so. So faith is me believing the Word of God. It's the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. Without faith, it's impossible to please God, but He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him, those who come unto Him believing that He is. So how do we stand fast? We stand fast in our freedom. We do not give up our freedom. That's a spiritual truth. That is a political truth. We cannot surrender our freedom. Sure, it would be much more comfortable for us at times to let 100 people in the church put together their minds and make us a list of rules, and if you go down this checklist and you meet every box, then you can be Antioch, and if you don't, then you cannot, but that's not Bible. Sure, it would be nice to have a government that fed us oatmeal every morning and a chicken leg every evening and gave us an allowance to go live our lives and we work like slaves and pay and make sure everybody has equal time. But see, the Bible says a man earns a living by the sweat of his face, so if he works harder and he sweats more, then he ought to make more. Amen? And sure, we help people, not because the government tells us to or overlords it, but because we've been given the truth and the freedom in Jesus to help one another. But the Bible also says in Galatians chapter 6 that if a man gets under a burden, you go help him, but you don't take it off of him. You help him bear his burden, but you don't take it from him and let him go. You help him, but you don't relieve him of his burden. That's anti-biblical. God does not get us out of every problem we're in, but He gets us through them. Stand on our freedom. Standing on our faith. Doing what God has called us to do no matter what it looks like. Because if you knew there was somebody standing at the door with a gun that said, if you worship Jesus today, I'm going to shoot you, you wouldn't do it. But if you close your eyes and can't see Him, you'd be in here like Ray Charles. My chains are gone. Right or wrong. We walk by faith and not by sight. You know why? Because it's ugly out there. It's ugly out there. And I got something else for you. There is an agenda. Can I say this? We don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against spiritual rulers in dark, high places in darkness. We see this coming against us. I don't think necessarily there are people that are against us, but I think there are people being puppeted by the devil in this country every day to take away our freedom. I don't think that they're necessarily enemies in their own mind of this country, but I think they've been possessed by the devil and they're being used to stand against us. We'll sell our soul for 2 shekels and a shirt. I'd rather somebody spoon feed me oatmeal than get out and work for a living and make my own way. The assurance of knowing that I'm going to have a bowl of oatmeal every day. I'm not against oatmeal. I had oatmeal this morning. It's just on my mind. Oh, you don't eat oatmeal because you like it. You eat oatmeal because you've got to eat something, right? Sweating all up in here. You just eat oatmeal because you've got to have something on your stomach and you can't eat donuts anymore. There's a faction that wants to take our freedom away. They want to enslave us. Communism is anti-Christianity, bypass capitalism. It's anti-Christianity. Socialism is the doorway into communism. There is an agenda in place to enslave us. You understand me? We have to stand fast in our freedom. And if the devil can beat us down in here, then the world can beat us down out there. And that's what they want from us. If the devil can stop us in here, then the world can have its way with us out there. So we have to do what? Stand fast. Hold the line. Because if you've got 4 5-star offensive linemen and 1 dud, then the line can be invaded and everybody's in trouble. If everybody does not do their job, because I can fight you right here, but I can't get you over here, and I can't get you back there. The biggest, strongest, most powerful warrior in the world is susceptible to being taken down or killed when somebody gets behind him. And that's what the devil's trying to do in the church. And that's what he's trying to do in this country. And that's what he's trying to do in our families. He's trying to break through the line and get us where we're vulnerable. He's like a roaring lion, the Bible says, walking to and fro, seeking out whom he can devour. And let me tell you what lions do. They come up on a herd of animals and they watch for the weak one. They watch for the sick one. They watch for the straying one. They don't go after the bull of the herd. They don't go after the big mama. No, they wait on one to get out, to stray away from the flock. They wait on one to slide out there. They wait on one to get tripped up or get distracted, and then they pounce. And that's what the devil's trying to do today. He's trying to pick apart those who are spiritually sick and spiritually separated from the flock. That's why we want people in church, because you need this. We need to be in church. Stand fast. Hold the line. Freedom. Faith, last of all, stand fast for our future. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, that we can be confident of this. The one that who began a work in us is going to continue that work in us till the day of the Lord Jesus. Why should we stand fast and hold the line? Jesus said this, John 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So what do? We undergird the burden of the hymnist who wrote these precious words. We'll work till Jesus comes. Do what God has called us to do. In this passage of Scripture, you see that Galatians chapter 5, he not only gives us this incredible exhortation to stand fast in the liberty, in the freedom, wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. But he also in Galatians 5 gives us the fruits of the Spirit of God. These things wherewith we can prove to ourselves that we're walking in God and doing what God wants us to be. Those fruits, he says, are this: joy, love, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Listen to what he says. Against such, there's no law. There is no law that can condemn you from being a person who walks in love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. There's no law against these things. So in the passage he says this, and I'll close with this. Verse 6, for in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. Paul is telling this people, hear me. Don't listen to what they're telling you. It's Jesus plus nothing. It's Jesus plus nothing. It don't matter if you've circumcised. It don't matter if you're uncircumcised. It don't matter if you're a Jew or a Greek. It doesn't matter what your ethnicity is. It doesn't matter what your sex is. It doesn't matter what society tells you. It's Jesus for all or nothing. Come to Jesus, he said. And Jesus works by faith through love. Verse 7, he said, you did run well. You were doing this. You had things where they were supposed to be. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? Verse 8, this persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. God didn't do this to you. God's not the author of confusion. God did not set you up for this. You've been behooved by the devil. Hear what he says, verse 9. A little leaven, leaven's the whole bunch. Just a little bit, leaven's the whole bunch. But hear what he says. I have confidence in you through the Lord that you will be none otherwise minded. But he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whoever he shall be. So what do? Stand fast. Because the one that seeks to destroy us, God's going to take care of him. I'm just dripping sweat. I don't know. Got lathered up this morning. I'm good to have some people in here. Amen. Stand fast. Hold the line. Because the devil's after this church. The devil's after your family. The devil's after this country. But he cannot penetrate the line if we stand fast on the principles of the book that God's put in our hand. If we do what God's told us to do, what does he say? On this rock, I'll build my church.
and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Stand with me. Father, we love you. God, we bless your name today for being so good to us. It sure is fun to preach to people. God, I thank you for folks that were able to be here. And Lord, we're no better than those who couldn't be. Lord, we pray today that you just bless this message, not because of who preached it or how we preached it, but because of the truth of it, that it ministered our hearts. We'll leave here strengthened. Lord, we got to stand fast. Hold the line. Uncertain days, for sure. But there is a certainty in the middle of all the uncertainty, and that is Jesus Christ and this word. It never changes. Lord, politics have changed. Society has changed. My goodness, has society changed. Things have changed in our lives, Lord, everything we know. But I know one thing that hadn't changed my entire life, 38 years almost on this earth. This book has never changed. You have never changed. I'm glad for my kids, and if you see fit to give me grandkids and great-grandkids and on down the line, that everything that may change, this word won't change. So let us stand fast on this book. Be the people you saved us and called us to be, and not be behooved by some perversion or strange gospel as to think that you're not everything. You are. Bless our invitation today. May there be one that needs Jesus. Let them come. Lord, if there's one today that needs to just get in this altar and pray for strength and encouragement to help them stand fast, your will be done as we are free in Jesus to do whatever we must. And we'll thank you for it and give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.